Yes, sir. It's Blake Larsen. Spelling is L-A-R-S-E-N. I'm a detective with the Criminal Investigations Division here in Overland Park. I appreciate you guys coming out. I just wanted to give a recent update on this case. I know a lot of people have been wanting to know, especially citizens, and I know I've been in constant contact with the family, so I'd like to give some updates on that as well. A recent update is we do have a new confirmed video from the second, so it's nothing new in terms of time, but a new video that shows Marilyn Carter in the area of West Memphis, Arkansas. It was a shell station off of I-55, just west of the Mississippi River. That is the last confirmed video contact that we have. That also shows where her cell phone pinged. That last ping is in that general area, as well as credit card purchase. I wanted to start from the beginning and give kind of a timeline so everybody knows what's going on. Marilyn left her Overland Park residence on Saturday, August 1st at approximately 8:15 p.m. She then traveled in her vehicle, a 2011 dark gray GMC Acadia with a Kansas license plate. I believe it's 194FYL. She traveled through Rolla, Missouri, making a stop at a McDonald's. We got credit card purchases there. And then eventually made it to West Plains, Missouri on August 2nd, Sunday morning at about 3:45 a.m. She then checks out a short time later at about 6:05, which obviously investigators and family found strange that it was that short of a stay. That was where we got our first video of her. And in that video, she is by herself in her vehicle and in the lobby. Doesn't look to be under duress. Doesn't look to be with anybody else. We got that video and credit cards there. Then she travels down to south to Arkansas, where she goes to a gas station or a convenience store in Hazen, Arkansas. We have a credit card purchase from there, and then travels on eastward to West Memphis, Arkansas, in the Memphis metropolitan area. That is where we got that last video with the help of the Arkansas State Police and the West Memphis Police Department. We got that last video there, and we've also done the phone ping through her cellular provider. And that last phone ping was at 8:02 p.m. on August 2nd, okay? Then the husband that night got concerned at approximately 3 in the morning to 4 in the morning, came and made a report. So now that's on August 3rd, makes a report at approximately 3 or 4 in the morning with us. And at that point, we get the report and we've kind of run point on it since she was last, you know, her husband was here. But she left Overland Park of her own free will with nothing suspicious afoot. And we've tracked her via credit card purchases, cell phone ping, and video. Again, that cell phone ping was along I-55 in the West Memphis, Arkansas area. The law enforcement community has been assisting us all over. We've had help. I want to specifically mention, in no particular order, the West Memphis, Arkansas Police Department, the Memphis, Tennessee Police Department, the Marion, Arkansas Police Department, the Arkansas State Police, their investigators, the Tennessee Bureau of Investigations, as well as some contacts with the Federal Bureau of Investigation and the U.S. Marshal's Office. We've also had help from agencies in Missouri, Mississippi, and Alabama. I've been keeping in contact daily with the Carter, Marilyn's family, Carter and Messler side, with her parents and her husband. This has kind of mushroomed into a lot of Good Samaritans and civilians helping in this search. And we appreciate that. Law enforcement, I want everybody to know, law enforcement is utilizing all logical and reasonable investigative techniques to locate Marilyn, including cell phone towers, pings, tracking her financial cards, the onboard tracking. OnStar has been a big one in the social media world, asking about OnStar. We've gone down that route. It's not possible. We've even gone satellite radio to see if they could track it that way. Not able to with the vehicle. We're analyzing Marilyn's cell phone records and her Google account. I want people to know we are doing everything possible. We've even attempted to get a search warrant in the Kansas courts for her cellular tower pings, just to show the route and where she'd been during that time. In the state of Kansas, the statute does not allow for the community caretaking function where we're looking for someone who is under duress. We can only get a search warrant for that kind of information for criminal activity. And at this time, there's no reason to believe that any criminal activity is afoot or anything nefarious has happened, especially in Overland Park, Kansas, or the Kansas City Metro. I have been told that the aviation units in Memphis, Tennessee, as well as water units, have conducted searches in that area, the last known ping, and the Mississippi River. Civilian organizations are helping with that search in the river with sonar and watercraft. That started yesterday in the water. The helicopters and the aircraft was prior in the week. The water searches started yesterday and are continuing into today. Again, I want to stress that this is not an active criminal investigation. We are simply trying to help the family locate Marilyn Carter and bring her back to her children, to her husband, to her parents. They're all worried sick about her. And I would like to also say that, you know, a lot of the people on social media that are suggesting things, you know, nefarious are not helping the case of trying to find her, you know, and it's I think that's hurting the, you know, family, thinking people are thinking that way. They're doing their best to try and locate her. They immediately went to the Memphis area. And when I say Memphis, I want to stress, we don't know if she's in Tennessee. We've got no evidence to ever suggest she went into Memphis, Tennessee. The path kind of stops at West Memphis, Arkansas. So with that, I'm not going to answer any questions as far as any mental health or anything. That would be for the family, and I know they've been willing to speak with media. But if you guys have any other questions that you or your viewers may want to know about, please feel free to ask them.
Any clues on the last video as opposed to the other videos, the August 2nd video?
So the videos are really similar, where she's by herself. We can confirm she's in a 2011 GMC Acadia. We don't get to see the tag, but we assume it's hers, right? So, yeah, all that logical evidence would suggest it's her vehicle. She's by herself. She's of her own free will. She's moving about. She goes into the convenience store on my last video. Looks like maybe she fills up a like a Yeti-type container she has, or a glass and with water. And then she gets gas outside, goes to her vehicle, and leaves. So there's nothing that we've seen in the video that's suspicious. It doesn't look like she's having any kind of crisis. So it's just been very, very difficult for us. I mean, we want to find her. And obviously this has been a tough, you know, 2 weeks. So
how challenging is it, though? I mean, we normally would work on the property, all these other places, all these other people. What's the challenge?
That is a huge challenge, and I have so much respect and admiration for my partners, Detective Weedle, Detective Johnson, Detective Lancaster, our analyst, crime analyst Glessner. They have been huge in helping me here in Overland Park, but it is so difficult to work something that's 400, 500 miles away, heck, even 700 if you get down into Alabama. But we've had law enforcement contacts and support throughout that region. And I'm grateful to those agencies that I've listed previously. You know, it's been very difficult, I will tell you that. We typically deal with our borders of Overland Park, and once in a while we'll go outside into the Kansas City Metro to help. So this has been very difficult to conduct a search or an investigation into a missing person. Again, not a crime to go away, but, you know, we want to find her. So it's been very difficult, that's a, to say the least, definitely.
Talk about the sonar search in the Mississippi River. What led authorities to believe that would be, you know, a place to search, or was a car found there, or what's the reasoning for searching the river?
So the reasoning for searching that river and doing aviation searches around the river is because of the proximity of the foam ping. We have not located any evidence to suggest she went in the river. We've located nothing that would suggest, you know, a vehicle drove off a bridge or went down, you know, an embankment, an accident. No evidence. It's just because of the sheer proximity. And obviously we have to use, you know, evidence, which we don't have any evidence of that, but we have to use the evidence of the phone ping and the location. And then when you go out into that radius, that's 2,500 meters for each direction for the radius, the Mississippi River's right there. So I think that people automatically begin to think, could she be in the river, which would be a tragic, you know, outcome for this. But we, you know, in law enforcement, we have to do, even though this is a community caretaking function and not a criminal investigation, we're going to do everything we can to try and find her. You know, hopefully she's alive and well. but we're going to do whatever we can to find her. And I think the Mississippi River, since it's in that radius, that's kind of a logical step. And I know that law enforcement has been a part of it, but we've also had people, citizens, good Samaritans, that have good sonar and stuff on their boats. And I'm not a boater, and I don't know much about sonar, but those people have gone out into the water because they want to help. They want to try and find her. And I guess the sonar nowadays, with the technology, they can, you know, if there's a vehicle in there, or they'll be able to find it, is what I've been told.
Is it possible to look at traffic cameras and maybe see where her car maybe turned and went from that Shell gas station?
We've done it all. Yeah, no, I promise you, we have tried, and we've even, Memphis has a real-time crime center where they, like, take in all their video in the city and all their traffic cam footage and their license plate readers. And I guess I was told there's two main bridges that go across from West Memphis, Arkansas, to Memphis, Tennessee. They've searched their license plate readers, their traffic camera footage, all traffic cam video, and they have not seen her. It's like I said, in West Memphis, after her phone goes off at 8:02, and that last purchase at the Shell station was approximately 5 p.m., 4:55 or something, it goes cold. I mean, we truly are, like, looking and doing everything we can, but we just haven't had anything else in that time period.
Do we know what she got from the gas station before her phone last?
So it looks like she went in and got water, which she didn't have to purchase, and I believe it was a $33.32 transaction at the pump, so fuel. And my partner, Detective Weedle, was nice enough to get the specs on a 2011 GMC Acadia, and it's got a 22-gallon gas tank, and an average of 18 miles per gallon, highway miles, I guess, which is roughly 400 miles. So if she turns her phone off at 8:02, never uses her credit card again, and drives 400 miles, I guess the radius could now be 800, you know, both ways. So that's kind of what we're looking at. You know, we've got to go off of the most recent phone ping. I mean, I think all of you, as well as me, I couldn't keep my phone off for 12 days. And I just today, this morning, checked with the cellular provider to see if that phone has pinged again since August 2nd, and it has not been turned back on.
So what about, you say this is not a crime at this point.
Correct.
You're allowed to do whatever you want to.
Yes, ma'am.
So how have the police that have been helping you responded to this, because it's not a crime?
Correct.
Somebody who just took off.
Yeah. They have responded very well, because I think in law enforcement as well as, like, news, I'm assuming there will be other news agencies that would like to get copies of your video. They're going to help us. So law enforcement, we make a call down there, email, and they want to help do whatever they can. But our hands sometimes, you know, figuratively can be tied when it's not a crime at this moment. For instance, if she wanted to just leave and run away and not be seen or talk to her family again, you know, obviously that would be a selfish thing. But if she's in a health crisis, you know, maybe that doesn't amount to that. But I would say that law enforcement in the region, all the way down through Alabama, have been very helpful. And I think that they've, you know, pulled out all the stops to help us locate. It might have taken us a few days to get traction, because, you know, there's a lot of missing persons cases. And you can't do what we've done on this missing persons case on all missing persons cases. But this is unique in the term of, you know, it was just a strange case when it came in. And so we've kind of started working it. And again, it took a few days to get steam, because other people didn't realize, you know, they just think it's a garden variety missing persons case. And that's not to say that those aren't more important than this. This is just a very unique and strange case.
Is this one unique because of the mental health aspect of it? I know you weren't going to talk in detail about is that aspect of it what has caused you guys to really go full bore on this deal?
I think that a lot of people that are missing, a lot of times those may be mental health related. So I don't think the mental health aspect has made us go, you know, all out like we always investigate all cases as hard as we can to try and find the people and bring them back for their loved ones. This one, I don't think the mental health aspect makes that different. What makes this one really strange is how everything just stopped at a certain time, you know, and we haven't had any sightings or heard from her since. A lot of the people that go missing, we can continue to track. We may not find an exact location, but their phone stays on, so we know they're in a certain city. Or, you know, this one is just strange how it just stopped.
And because this isn't a criminal investigation, how long will you guys continue to, you know, have search efforts? And is there a time period where you kind of stop?
Yeah. Well, that's a great question, because I've even asked Detective Weedle and my sergeant and my captain, how long do we continue? Because for 2 weeks, this has pretty much been my focus, you know, and I have other cases that I've got to work. We all do, all the detectives do, and we're busy. So how long can you spend on something like this? You know, the family wants us to spend forever, and we're going to do as much as we can. But at some point, I've got to get back to other cases. But I obviously sympathize with them. There's not a cut and dried timeline. You know, if we keep getting good tips, we'll keep working them. But at this point, the tips we've gotten haven't panned out. The tips we've gotten, some of them have been great, you know, and the resemblances are somewhat close, but it's not her. Other tips have really hampered our time, because we have to follow up these leads. And you can tell that there's nothing to those tips. But again, if you have a good tip, and you think you know where she or her vehicle is, please reach out to either the Overland Park Police Department if it's locally. But I also want to stress, if somebody in West Memphis or in that area, the Memphis, Tennessee, or down in Alabama sees her or the vehicle, contact your local police, because she is entered into NCIC as a missing and endangered person. So if we run her and have contact with her nationwide, she's going to come back flagged as a missing person. And the best way to get her help and get her reunited with her family would be to contact that, just hypothetically, let's say it's Birmingham, Alabama. Contact Birmingham, Alabama first, and then feel free to give me a call. I want to talk to the people that have tips. But if she's in Birmingham, Alabama, and you call me, this isn't Criminal Minds, and we don't have a jet set up ready to go. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm stuck here. You call me, all I can do is call. So that's kind of what's made it very difficult about that distance in this investigation.
Can you just clarify the difference between missing person and then missing person in danger?
Correct. Yes, I will definitely. So there's a lot of different categories, and some states do things differently. For instance, if you're a missing endangered, I learned in Alabama, you can be put in as a silver alert, where that's more of an elderly missing person that may have dementia or Alzheimer's, you know. In Kansas, a missing person is someone that you believe maybe just left and the family hasn't heard from them and they want to know where they're at. When we move it to a missing endangered and it becomes more severe is when there may be a mental health aspect or a health aspect, you know, maybe you're a diabetic and you forgot your medications, those types of things. That's where it becomes a little bit more urgent, and that missing endangered. And then obviously you have your Amber Alerts and your Silver Alerts, which are also missing persons, but they're different classifications.
You mentioned the restrictions when it comes to phone records, and I imagine the intention behind that is to protect the privacy of a living person.
Correct.
Can you talk about some of the other barriers or challenges that you face, you know, whether it's technology, or you mentioned the tips that kind of take you down a different path, just some of the challenges or roadblocks you've run into?
Yeah, absolutely. So when you're asking about the technology and some of the roadblocks we've had as far as the cell phone, you know, like I said, the state of Kansas and the statute for getting a search warrant directly specifies criminal activity. And it's not illegal for a person who wants to just get away and leave their life behind to leave. So because of that, we can't just go out and, you know, be Big Brother and get a search warrant through the state courts or the federal courts and track these people. Obviously, the United States Constitution is there to protect us, right? And if you want to just be free and live off the grid, you can. So it makes it difficult when we're trying to find someone that we believe is missing and in a crisis, maybe. But short of that, in our state, in Kansas, short of having that criminal element, we can't go, what's the right word? Not violate, because we don't do that. But we can't go circumvent the U.S. Constitution to track people. You know what I'm saying? We abide by the U.S. Constitution, and we're not going to track people that don't want to be found if they haven't committed a crime. And there's been no crime committed. So that's why it's been really tough. It's you know, handcuffed us in that aspect. But every state is different, and it sounds like, after speaking with the Arkansas State Police, they believe that they can get a search warrant for her cellular tower data, which shows pings, basically triangulates where you're at, because your phone has to hit off of a tower. So it'll show kind of the route she's taken before the phone was off. And Arkansas State Police believe that they can get that through their state courts.
Hey, you're obviously really good at what you do, and you've been doing it for a long time. So in your professional opinion, I mean, there must be some sort of, hey, we believe that she's in danger or maybe some foul play. So in your professional opinion, do you think there has been foul play or she is injured or dead or something like that? Like, what are the chances that this is going bad?
Well, I appreciate the compliment. I think some of my colleagues would disagree that I'm really good at what I do. But no, I mean, we all try, and we have a lot of experience and training. I obviously appreciate your question. I'm not going to speculate on the outcome. But yeah, I mean, we feel that because of what we learned from the family, and like I said, I'm not going to speak to specifics on mental health, but what we learned from the family and how maybe she was feeling and thinking, we feel that it's urgent to try and find her. And every day that ticks on, I think that, you know, I mean, we haven't had any contact since the 2nd. So, we are keeping our fingers crossed, and, you know, whatever God you pray to, I'm praying to God that, you know, we can find her alive and well. But I appreciate your question. Man, you are good. You're very good. Again, if I speculate on that and give a 50-50, I'd be lying to you, because I don't have exact statistics on how this works out. I will tell you, more often than not in Overland Park, our missing people are found safe. But we always have, you know, those outliers, and I hope this isn't one of them.
Guys, we have time for one more question.
We're good.
Do we know the nature of the initial trip? Was this impromptu? Was this a planned trip? Do we have any specifics about the nature of that helps clue you in here?
Yeah, so I do have some specifics on that. So I spoke with, obviously, Marilyn's mother and Marilyn's husband. And it is my understanding that Marilyn's sister in Alabama is supposed to have a baby. I think maybe the due date is this Monday, or I'm not sure. Don't quote me on the due date. But she was going to make a trip to go down to see family and possibly seek some health care. What the extent of that health care is, again, you would have to ask the family. I know that I spoke with her husband, and that she had purchased a ticket with Southwest Airlines to fly Southwest from KCI to Birmingham, Alabama on Sunday, August 2nd. They purchased that ticket on Saturday, August 1st. It was a late purchase. She took a nap. They purchased that in the early afternoon, I believe. She took a nap during the day, woke up, and something in her mind, the anxiousness or whatever, she was like, I'm not going to wait for the flight. I want to leave tonight. So it was planned, but it was also spur of the moment. She was planning to go to Alabama. So she never used her flight, and she left to go to Alabama in the middle at 8:15 that night.
Did she tell her family she was going to go ahead and drive, or did she just go?
She told her husband. Her husband knew that she was leaving, and her husband was concerned that she was going to go. But again, you know, I don't think we know the extent sometimes of our loved ones, you know, thoughts or anything. And she's anxious and wants to go. Maybe it's because she's excited to get down there and see her sister, and she just wants to drive through the night, right? So he was comfortable in letting her go. And I don't fault him for that. And nobody else, I don't think, on social media or whatever should. Because I don't really look at a lot of that social media, but I've been told by people kind of what's been going around. So, yeah, that good question. You brought up something I wasn't going to answer, but I talk about the airline ticket just because I think that helps give kind of a view into her mindset.
Okay,